Within 3 days of Call of Duty Warzone's release, 3 million people across the planet were playing. Well, great, you say, they marketed the game well. Did those people keep playing? Within a month, there was 50 million people playing Warzone. On the outside, Warzone just looks like an innocent bit of fun. But when we peek behind the curtains, we'll understand how much of a masterpiece this is. A game design masterpiece that's been carefully crafted to get you to play, then to keep playing, and to keep playing again and again and again until you become addicted. So in this video, I don't just want to peek behind the curtains and show you what they're doing. I want to rip off the curtains, reveal exactly what these people are doing in order to get you addicted. Gaming addiction's an interesting topic to talk about because I've been through it. You know, gaming's been around my whole life. It started with the Game Boy Color, the PlayStation 1, then the PlayStation 2, and then the Nintendo Wii, then the Xbox 360, then the PS3, and then it went across to gaming. And I went from playing Minecraft with my friends on the weekend to spending literally every single waking minute of my life playing on my computer. I would stop playing football so that I could play on my computer. Relationships with friends would start to slip away. Very quickly, without really knowing what happened, I found myself in a rut. So I would try and get out of it. I knew that spending all of this time on gaming probably wasn't the best idea. There was times I'd try and delude myself by pretending I was trying to become a professional CSGO player, professional video game player. I knew that wasn't the case, so I would try and stop. I'd make progress, I'd watch videos, I'd read personal development books, and I promised myself that I'm going to change, I'm going to slip back out of my old habits, and I'd do it. I'd uninstall the game, I would stop playing for a couple days, and then I'd slip back into old habits. And that cycle would rinse and repeat again and again and again. I was on some kind of a roller coaster, going up and then down, making progress and slipping back, and I just couldn't figure out why. And up until recently, most people would hear this, the generations above us, and they would think, don't be so ridiculous. Just stop playing, just get over it. It's just a game. It's just some pixels on the screen. Well, actually, video game addiction has been recognized by WHO as a mental health disorder. These are real problems that we're talking about, and it's something we've got to address. If anything takes up that much time of our life, I'm the founder of Time Theory, and if something's taking up that much of our time, we've got to at least look into it. But before I get onto the topic of really explaining what video games are doing to your brain, let me first include a couple disclaimers. I'm not saying all video games are bad, I'm not saying that at all. I've enjoyed video games healthily before and it's been great. When it comes to using your time, there's a simple equation for productivity. Inputs divided by outputs. What are the inputs? What are this activity taking? What time is it taking you? What energy is it taking from you? And what are the outputs? What do you receive on the other side? It's a simple process. And most of the time, for most people, the inputs are many, many, many hours, 10, 12 hours, every single day, every waking second, you're thinking about the video game. It's consuming your mind. That's the input. And the output is not much. A little escape from reality. But instead of just escaping from reality, why not try and identify the root causes and try and deal with them? Now, I know this is always possible. I'm making some large generalizations. And for a lot of people, the inputs of video games are just a couple hours here and there. Spending some time with your friends, that's the input. It's healthy. And the outputs are actually, well, I actually need a break from reality. This is actually good for my mental health. The equation that you've got to remember is inputs divided by outputs. What inputs are you putting into video games? And what outputs are you receiving from them? And if the outputs aren't worth the inputs, then you've got to consider taking some kind of a break. But why are these games actually so addictive? Why can pixels on a screen be enough to encapsulate you, to put you into a different world, and to watch hours go by as if you didn't realize what happened? What's going on behind the scenes? And why are video games so addictive? What are they doing to your brain? Well, the core premise comes down to Skinner's box experiment, which is to do with doing an activity and getting the reward. And this is what the whole Dopamine Detox series is about. If you haven't watched the Dopamine Detox Mental Momentum course, there's a link in the description to a free course here on YouTube that's going to walk you through everything when it comes to rewiring your brain and resetting from getting stimulus and getting dopamine. So Skinner's box, when you do an activity, you get a result. The first part, and I'm going to list many, many, many ways that video games get you addicted. The first part is very simply, you do something and you get a reward. For example, on Call of Duty Warzone, if you kill somebody, you get XP. You do the thing and you get the reward. And this is true of loads of video games. And it's this reward that starts to make a habit in your brain. We all know the phrase, neurons that fire together wire together. So when we get that dopamine, it actually makes it easier for that craving to get that dopamine again. So we find ourselves in a loop. We also know cue, routine, reward. This is how habits are formed. And the stronger the reward, the more likely you are to do the routine when you get a cue. So because video games are carefully engineered to do lots of different things to release dopamine in your brain, to give you some kind of a reward, it gets you hooked and you find yourself coming back again and again and again. And there are multiple different ways that you can get a reward. For example, you can do an activity, you can get the same reward every single time. But what video game developers have found that if there's a variable rate reward, you're far more likely to come back again and again. What that means is if you do an activity, the reward you get isn't constant, it differs every single time. For example, if you want to train a dog, instead of giving him a reward every time he does something well, you should actually intersperse the rewards you give him. Sometimes you give him loads of rewards and sometimes you don't give him many rewards at all. This variable rate of rewards is by far the most stimulating place. Remember, dopamine isn't just the reward neurotransmitter, it's the craving neurotransmitter. You get the most dopamine not once you've achieved the thing, but in expectation of receiving the reward. So if the outcome, the reward, you don't know quite what it's going to be, then the reward becomes far more tantalizing when you do get it. And it's the craving that becomes incredible. That's why with gambling, you don't know what the outcome's going to be, and that's why it's so intense. In the video game CSGO, you're given a rank. This rank is meant to be how good you are at the game. If you win multiple games in a row, you get moved up a rank and you're playing with more difficult people. But the thing is, your rank and how far you are or how close you are to the next rank, they keep that hidden, which means after you've won a game, you're expecting to get promoted, but you don't know just how far away you are from getting the promotion. So you win the game and you're not quite sure if you're going to get promoted or whether it's going to be the next game that you get promoted. And because they keep that hidden, it's all carefully done. They do this with a purpose. And the reason they do that is because when you don't know the reward, it's far more stimulating when you get the reward. But even the fact that there are ranks, again, it's tapping into human psychology to get you addicted. If we look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, literally the top of the pyramid, the top, the most important thing is feeling like you're making progress. And by giving you these ranks, by giving you this score, by giving you this data point to determine how valuable you are, when you see that data point trick up, you feel like you're improving yourself. But here's the thing. Growth for the sake of growth is the mindset of a virus, not of a human. I said this in the last video and you guys seem to really enjoy it. Improving yourself for the sake of improving yourself is pointless. What is the utility of that improvement? Just because you've ranked up, just because you've got more XP in a game, that doesn't mean you're actually improving yourself. What utility does that have in the real day-to-day life? How can you benefit yourself? How can you benefit humanity with that improvement? You simply can't. So what these video games are doing is they're tapping into human psychology to make you feel like you're living an incredible life, when in reality, oftentimes the opposite may be true. And when you think about it, in sports, or if you're competing for a job or you're a musician trying to get to the top, all humans have a tendency to compete. And I believe, due to evolutionary psychology, this is true because us as a tribe, we wanted to compete against other tribes and other animals so that we could be the top. It's survival of the fittest. But Warzone takes this to a whole nother level. First of all, when you win, you're congratulated on an insane level. Music plays, everybody sees your name, you feel like you've done something incredible, you've beaten all of these other people, you've beaten all of these other tribes. But not only that, you're in a community. You've got a team with you. That is your tribe. You have built a community when it randomly assigns you with teammates that you're working together with. It's literally our tribe versus their tribe, and that's why it feels so great when you can work together as team, as brothers, to win. And the creators of Warzone know that if they can create a game where you can play with your friends, Now they've added in the element of peer pressure, because as humans, we're social beings, we don't want to let down our friends. So if all of our friends are playing, and they know that the team's going to do better if you're playing, you feel socially obligated to go to war with your tribe. And there's now an added element of peer pressure where if you don't play, you feel like you're missing out. And it feels like all of your friends are bounding together, going towards one common purpose together. They're a team, and you're not playing. It feels like you're missing out. They're doing this all carefully and purposefully. And I mentioned there that all of the team is coming together with one common purpose, and that's just another one of the hundreds of things that video game developers do to keep you hooked. They give you a purpose. In Warzone, they do this especially well. In most battle royale games, the purpose is to win. It's to survive, it's to kill everybody else. But in Warzone, they take this to the next level. Yes, that's the grand mission to win, but there's also side quests along the way. Find loot caches, or go to a certain area of the map, or kill a rival team. It's all done so that you feel like you're consistently making progress towards a grand purpose, a grand mission. If you live your life and you haven't yet figured out what your purpose is, video games give you that purpose, and of course that's compelling. Every human being wants to be using their time in development of some kind of a purpose, in search of some kind of a goal, and video games give that to you perfectly. And video games make this so much more clear than we can ever get in real life. In real life, you can say, right, this is the goal that I want to get to. There's always doubts if that's the best goal, there's always doubts on how you're going to get there. Video games remove all complexity to a level that life just can't compete with those video games. Because in video games, it says, this is your objective, 100%. There is no doubt in your mind that this is your objective. This is what you've got to do. Your time must be spent towards reaching that objective. There is so much clarity on that objective because it just comes off in a one-word sentence. And how can real life compete when life is more chaotic, life is more crazy, it's more difficult to understand why we're here. It's more difficult to figure out how to use your time. And that's why so many people find themselves spending more time in video games, more time in a virtual reality than real life. And to top it all off, we have the sunk cost fallacy, which is a general human thinking heuristic that says, if you've invested a lot of time or money into something, you shouldn't just give it up. This is why so many people, I believe, stay in toxic relationships past the point that they should give up. They think, I've spent so much time and money on this person, I've invested so much of myself, that the brain thinks that it's not worth leaving and trying to start something new. With video games, once they've got you hooked and you've put in 50 hours, 100 hours, 200 hours, it's so difficult to leave that game and to start doing something else because you're good at the game, and if you're trying to learn a new skill, you're not good at that thing. So it seems so much easier to stick with what you're good at instead of leaving and trying to do something else. Now, all of these things that I've just talked about, all of these ways that video games use to get you hooked, them in and of themselves, they're not bad tactics. I use a lot of them in the procrastination program to help people use their time wisely. I believe it comes down to intent and why they want your attention. Because let's be honest, in these free-to-play games, the reason that these game developers want your attention is so that they can either show you adverts in the form of Facebook or Instagram, well, there's microtransactions, there's in-app purchases, there's ways for you to spend money inside of the game. And that's why so many games have introduced the element of gambling. Gambling takes the variable ratio reward to a complete new level. You're putting money on the line and you don't quite know what you're going to get in return for that money. The reward could be incredible, it could be massive. On the flip side, you don't know. And what they do, and this is why Candy Crush became so incredible, is they use a phrase where when you're doing this gambling, you're either winning by a lot or you're losing by a little. Ever notice in gambling sites, you get very, very close to winning. If you've got a scratch card, you get 2 out of 3 of the things that you need, and the third one is ever so slightly off. So when you lose, you're only losing by a little, so your brain's thinking, oh, I was so close to winning. And then when you win, you're winning by a lot. You're winning by an incredible amount. These are all things that are designed to get you hooked. And at the end of the day, what you've got to consider is inputs versus outputs. Are the inputs of video games worth the outputs? Are the time and the energy spent on these games worth the rewards or the costs that you're getting on the other side? Or is it not worth it? Just like you should try and identify whether the inputs of engaging with this video are worth the outputs. If you spend a few seconds liking the video and subscribing, then more positive videos are going to come on your homepage. Inputs are just a few seconds, and the output is you're filling up your homepage with positive videos that are going to improve your life. I'm stretching for that one, but it's true. The same thing applies. Remember, inputs divided by outputs. So to finish off, your action item for this video is to spend 30 seconds trying to identify whether the inputs of video games are worth the outputs. Just 30 seconds really asking yourself that question, not trying to shy away from the answer. I'll see you in the next video.